Before I begin, I just want to acknowledge some of our funding partners and collaborators on a project that I'm going to be touching on during this webinar. The GNLCC for funding and also for hosting this webinar, USGS, the Fish and Wildlife Department of Colville Tribes, Bonneville Power Administration, and the University of Idaho and Boise State University. So I'm going to start out just by kind of going over some very basic stuff of eDNA and some sort of generalized steps involved in this method from sample collection to molecular assay design. And then I'll touch on some of the findings of our recent study that focused on salmon, and then wrap up by going over some of the challenges that are unique to eDNA analysis. First off, what is it about eDNA analysis that lends itself to monitoring imperiled species? Because a species is imperiled, it's generally present at low density. And using traditional methods, this can make detection difficult, time-consuming, and often expensive. Additionally, sometimes the impact of these survey methods are actually counterproductive to conservation efforts. eDNA analysis offers a different method for determining presence of aquatic species, potentially a highly sensitive method and one that's non-invasive. Also, once some of the preliminary work's been done on the front end, it then, you know, requires very little effort to conduct these surveys. So let's start out just by talking about what environmental DNA or eDNA is and some of its potential sources. eDNA is just naturally occurring genetic material. It can be dissolved or cell-bound, and it persists for a time in the environment, independent of the organism that it originated from. Sources of this eDNA can be just naturally sloughed cells, as well as any excretions from living organisms, as well as decaying tissue can introduce a lot of DNA in an environment as well. This genetic material becomes suspended in water, as it's broken down by UV radiation and bacterial mechanical digestion, and eventually drops out of suspension. But while it's suspended there, these cells or these dissolved fragments of DNA, they can be collected in a water sample and concentrated. Currently, there's a handful of different sampling methods that have been used. For example, we've used these sterile disposable filter funnels. They house a 0.45 micron pore diameter cellulose nitrate filter membrane. And in the systems that we've been working in, this usually allows for filtering of a liter or more of water before that filter becomes clogged. But this is only one of several sample collection methods, and this is one of the areas of this rather new field that hasn't really been thoroughly examined in terms of a comparison between all these methods. Good news is that, you know, we might not know which is the best method. Most of these methods that have been used do seem to be working. For more information on some of these sampling methods, I should point out that we put together a fact sheet that was published by USGS that's available through this link at the top, or you can just email me and I can send you a copy of this. But it contains information for somebody that's considering using eDNA as a monitoring tool. And it includes a table that kind of outlines several of the sample collection and preservation methods that have been employed to date. So depending on the environment that you're planning to sample, there's been a wide range of sample volumes that have been used from 15 mils up to 5 and 10 liters. These are generally preserved using ethanol or freezing or some combination of these. But once your samples are collected and preserved, the DNA can then be extracted and then analyzed. The DNAs also can be archived. And keep in mind that these samples here, they would contain DNA not just from your target organism, but potentially from any of the organisms present at a sample site. Therefore, they essentially are providing you with a snapshot in time of biodiversity at a site. They can be reanalyzed later on to screen for presence of additional species. I think this is a unique aspect to eDNA sampling, you know, that we can revisit a site in time just by reanalyzing an archived DNA sample. In order to analyze a sample, a molecular marker has to be developed. And this can be done especially for some of the more common species using sequence databases such as GenBank. For some of the lesser studied species where a lot of sequences might not be available on these databases, You may have to generate the sequences yourself from tissue samples. But once you've identified a sequence that's unique to your target organism, you can choose a set of primers and molecular probe to amplify this sequence. And then to ensure the specificity of that assay, it needs to be tested. And we test this just by making sure that, and if I use Chinook salmon as an example here, you know, every time we test the Chinook tissue sample, it needs to produce a positive test result, while eDNA from, or just DNA, excuse me, from all these other and closely related species that are likely to be present in the system that I'm sampling, you need to make sure that DNA from those fail to produce positive test results. And then just a very general approach to applying this eDNA method to a landscape might work like this. And this is obviously going to depend on the goals of the study. But if I take just a typical dendritic stream network, these red dots would indicate sample sites. And in this example, they were placed on either fork just above the confluences. Where's my cursor here? Just above these confluences, so that if we were to get a positive detection at this site, you know, that would suggest that DNA came from somewhere upstream in this segment. Positive detection at this site would suggest that it came from somewhere upstream in the remainder of that stream section. And, you know, we can continue to break that stream network up into smaller units for inference. So at each site, we'd collect our samples, extract the DNA from those samples, and amplify the sequence, our target sequence, if it's present in the sample, and then determine presence based on those results. And this example is just showing a qPCR analysis. But again, this is just a sort of general approach that I'm outlining here. It's more or less one that we used in a collaborative effort between USGS, the Great Northern LCC, and the Fish and Wildlife Department of the Colville Tribes that focused on monitoring salmonage in large western watersheds. And I think I might just ask, or just take a quick break here and just, before I kind of go into the details of that study, just take a moment, open up for questions, because I'm not going to go into much more detail on sampling materials and methods or assay design. I'm going to kind of jump into some other topics. So if folks have any questions on actual materials or sampling techniques or any of those things, I'm happy to try to answer those now, or we can always wait and take them at the end as well.
Great. It looks like we do have a question from Patrick DeHaan. He would like to know, how do you preserve the filters?
The filters are just preserved in ethanol. We use forceps and remove those in the field. I guess this image here, you can actually see removing that filter from this disposable filter funnel. That's just kind of folded up and actually stored in a molecular grade 100% ethanol in a vial.
Great, thank you. I don't see any other questions.
Okay.
Oh, we do. Sorry, one more from Robert Long. Sorry about that. He says, I've heard eDNA can be used with soil samples for terrestrial species. Is this true?
I haven't worked with that. I've heard some folks talking about attempting that. I really haven't seen any publications on it, but I think it sounds intriguing.
Great. He says, thanks.
Yeah, sorry, I don't have too much information. I've just mostly been doing this stuff in aquatic systems, but I have heard some discussion about trying to apply it in some terrestrial environments as well. Okay, let's go ahead and just move on then. So this, I'm going to kind of transition now and talk about how we applied this in that project I described. And this shows the Chief Joseph Hatchery. This is on the Columbia River near the mouth of the Okanogan River. The Colville tribes, through this hatchery, you know, this just opened up last June, they're working to reestablish a spring-run Chinook in the Okanogan River. It's a strain that's been extirpated since around the 1930s, and currently they do have some fall-run Chinook in that system. But we were interested in using the approach that I kind of outlined and to integrate that approach into an eDNA detection approach as a component in their monitoring program and to monitor recolonization of tributaries by these spring Chinook. So we sampled prior to their proposed release of this fish into the Okanagan, the idea being that, you know, this could establish a baseline distribution prior to that reintroduction effort, sort of just a map of where Chinook are now. And then with ongoing eDNA sampling, hopefully we're going to be able to track changes in their distribution and get a better idea of which tributaries are recolonized by spring Chinook. And the idea is not necessarily to have eDNA replace all their traditional aquatic sampling methods, such as electrofishing and their snorkel surveys, weir traps, and pit tagging. But it may be a useful tool to rapidly cover a big piece of this landscape and gain some insight and help resource managers to prioritize and allocate their resources so they can get a better return on their efforts. Let's take a look at the landscape now. Here's the Okanagan on the right. This is where the release of those spring Chinook is proposed. And we also included the Methow sub-basin in this study, mainly because it was a nearby basin and it already contained a fall run Chinook and a spring run Chinook. You can see the Okanagan sub-basin. It spans the U.S. and Canadian border and encompasses lands that are managed by private, state, federal, and tribal agencies. So here's the actual sample sites that we used. These purple lines that we're seeing on here, that represents the known distribution of Chinook in this area as of 2007. And as you can see, we have sites within that known distribution and sites outside of it. And we sampled all of these sites twice, once during high flows and again during low flows. If we look at this site here, this is the lowest site in the Methow sub-basin. We can see this is just a hydrograph from USGS stream gauge that was near that site. But if we look at our actual sample dates, we have our high flow sampling event that was basically during spring runoff in June, and it flows around 6,000 CFS at that site. And then our second event during low flow flows at that site had been reduced about 800 CFS. And this is just for the one site, but throughout both the Methow and the Okanagan, this sort of relationship held where flows were about 8 or 10 times higher in June than they were in August. I'm showing you just to kind of give you an idea of some of the type of streams and the conditions, you know, where these methods have been applied. This is an upper section in the Methow. It's a typical river in our study area. And you can see bank full on the left there during high flow, and then the flows are greatly reduced by August. This is just a typical tributary in the system. It might have been difficult to cross during high flows, and then you can, you know, likely hop across without getting your feet wet in August. And this would be our smallest stream site that we sampled, and it's, you know, basically just a trickle in August. And that's just to give an idea of kind of the range and size of these streams that were included in the study. So what we found was using eDNA, we were able to detect Chinook in all of the places where we expected to, based on that known distribution that I showed. We also detected Chinook in 5 additional sites, which represent a possible expansion of their known distribution. We also had high detection probabilities throughout. During high flows in June, we had a 0.69 detection probability. And then as flows were reduced in August, we had a 0.98 for a combined of 0.83. So overall, it was very high detection probability during either flow conditions. We put this back on the landscape. You can look at those two sampling events in terms of detection and concentration. We're looking right now at June, so this is during high flows. If we focus on these X's, they represent sites where we failed to detect Chinook, and the circles represent sites where we did detect Chinook. So if I kind of toggle between this June high flow event and then this August low flow event, especially if we focus on, where's my cursor here? If we focus on like this area here, for example, here we are in June, you can see all these X's where we were failing to detect Chinook in those areas, whether that's due to high flow or the fish not actually being present in June. And then as we go to August, you can see all these sites eventually become occupied or we're able to detect them. And then also, I'm going back to June now here. These circles, the actual size of the circles representative of the concentration of eDNA at the sites. And you can see the size of those circles actually increases from June here to August here. I'm showing you just these results just in the Methow here as this example, but the monitoring the Okanagan is going to be more of an ongoing process as these fish eventually return to the basin over the upcoming years. And hopefully we're able to capture some of the changes in their distribution as they recolonize some of the tributaries in this basin. So you can see we have sort of just a linear distribution along the main stem of the Okanagan for Chinook. And based on some of the life history assumptions for the spring Chinook, we're expecting some of these X's and these smaller tributaries to eventually become occupied by that strain. Another thing we were curious about was false negatives, or you know, how many replicates do we actually need to be collecting to minimize these false negatives? And at each of our sites, we use triplicate sampling, so we filtered 3 1-liter water samples per visit. And we found that was that 90% of our sites were either all negative or all positive, leaving only 10% of our sites that had some ambiguity where there was maybe a single rep or two of the reps that were positive. So when we had confirmed presence, and so that's not based on that assumed known distribution, this is now just when we'd go and sample and at least one of our three replicates was positive for Chinook. So when we had that, only 7% of the replicates were actually falsely negative. What that means is that at least for our goals, this may be a reasonably low rate, and that for our target organism, Chinook, and in this system, we might be able to get away with fewer replicates per site visit. We could possibly reduce this just to 2 and actually include more sites. Let's switch gears just a little bit here and consider some of the challenges that are specific to eDNA techniques, as I think it requires some considerations. One of the challenges is interpretation of positive results. The most likely explanation for a positive result is going to be actual presence of that target organism near the sample site. One of the limitations of this method is that it's currently difficult to say much beyond that. For example, we don't know with any certainty how many of them there were. Was it a single adult or was it 100 juveniles? And while there's some evidence that eDNA concentrations identified using qPCR can in some cases correlate with some actual species densities, we're not currently at a point where we can apply this across the board. The map of concentrations that I showed you with those circle sizes, that might be able to give you some insight regarding relative densities, but without having truth to compare those values to, we really don't know for certain the extent, what were the extent of environmental factors and what was their impact on that variation. We also don't know how near an organism is when we get a positive detection. The limitation or upstream inference is currently poorly understood. And I think that's something that deserves to be examined in the future. Also, how recently was the organism present? It seems, and studies have shown based on looking at persistent time of eDNA in water, that this seems to be at least, within sort of a biologically relevant time frame, somewhere in the neighborhood of days to weeks. And I think this persistence time may also eventually be informative with regards to the upstream inference as well. But what this kind of points out is that there's a lot of environmental factors, and most of these are really only poorly understood at this point. And to kind of further illustrate the complexity of interpreting eDNA concentrations beyond just presence, if we think about the concentration of eDNA being likely a function of the rate of production minus the rate of degradation, and again, just using fish as an example here, some of the factors that influence production can be fish density, fish health, and the reproductive status of the fish at the time of sampling, as well as their metabolism. And some of the factors that influence degradation can be UVB exposure at the site, water temperatures, adsorption to other molecules in the system, and possibly pH. And then, you know, you consider that the environment has this influence over both of these aspects, and to sort of a constantly varying degree. This can really cloud our ability to say anything beyond presence, even though we're currently able to quantify the amount of DNA at a site using that quantitative PCR. So it's a limitation at this point, but I think there's going to be a lot of interesting work done that's hopefully going to shed some light on these environmental effects with regards to eDNA. Another one of the challenges that's inherent to eDNA analysis is dealing with potential contamination. Contamination can take on a lot of forms from start to finish in an eDNA study. However, with proper precautions, these should all really be fairly unlikely, and there are controls that we can use to identify it if it were to happen. The reason I even bring this up is mainly just to point out that it's something that needs to be considered and factored in when planning to use eDNA as a monitoring tool. That's both from a logistic and a budgetary standpoint. So I'm going to point out some of those sources and how we generally deal with these. Now, the first one is site contamination. And this can be, you know, natural or human caused, and it can be, if we think of a target organism like salmon, you know, at least seasonally, they can be decaying in mass, and they're fed upon by other animals, and there is some risk that this genetic material can be transported around a study area this way. And also, there are sport fish, which means people are fishing for them. And, you know, you can imagine if someone were to fillet fish and throw carcasses in the stream behind the house and you sample downstream, that can have an effect on your results. But it just kind of points out that, you know, you need to understand the target organism as well as the environment that's going to be sampled to help you determine when to sample. And with that in mind, it's repeated sampling over time has really been used as a way to strengthen the evidence that the species was actually present and then that it wasn't caused by some of these sort of chance events. Another potential source of contamination is through field equipment. You know, as you visit one site to the next, careful sterilization between sites has been used to minimize this, and also just including field negative controls, which is going to add to the cost of the overall sampling, but it will allow you to identify if that was the cause of introducing that genetic material there. Also, this contamination issue just needs to be a concern on the lab side as well. It can be minimized with sterilization again, and importantly, it can also be minimized by using separate labs for the various stages of extraction and analysis. Mainly, the idea is to separate steps that involve high copy number PCR product from some of the other low copy number steps in the process, like your assay design steps and the filter, DNA extraction from your filters or water samples. And again, just including negative controls at each one of these steps in the lab process can allow you to identify that contamination if it were to occur. And even on this lab site, of course, it's increasing your overall cost. As for future application, it seems eDNA analysis is gaining some traction as a tool for conservation. When used as an initial survey for presence, I think it can allow managers to rapidly prioritize stream reaches or water bodies and better allocate their limited resources to certain areas that are going to provide the greatest return for their conservation efforts. There seems to be a tremendous potential in the possibility of doing entire biodiversity assessments using deep sequencing techniques. That's something that I'm hearing about. It's not something I'm directly involved in, but the idea is just sequencing all the available DNA in these samples rather than looking at single or a couple of species presence analysis. And with that, that kind of wraps up the talk I have prepared here. And I just want to thank Great Northern LCC for hosting this. And hopefully we have a little discussion and I can try and answer some of the questions you folks have.
Great. Thank you, Matthew. That was very interesting. So again, if you have a question, you can select the hand icon next to your name. I can unmute you and you can talk to Matthew directly, or you can type a question into the question box and I can read it. So I'll give people a few moments to gather their questions. And if they had any questions after this, I'm sure, Matthew, you'd be open to people emailing you or contacting you.
Yeah, definitely.
Great. Great. Okay. Here we go. Philip Dam would like to know, what are the costs, say, for an individual sample for one species?
An individual sample on the actual analysis, you know, I've heard somewhere in the realm of $35, $35 to $50 to actually process that from start to finish. That's kind of deceiving. That's assuming that you already have a molecular assay worked out and that you can just apply to a sample, which that's kind of the upfront startup cost is developing that assay and testing it, and that requires a fair amount of lab work. But then once you have that, you kind of you can run with just applying that to the landscape. So, you know, that's kind of the numbers that we've been dealing with when we've been doing some of these projects is just for chemicals and for lab time and all that, somewhere in that realm of $30 to $50. I'd expect those costs to come down, though, obviously, as some of the stuff becomes cheaper.
Great. And we have another, we have quite a few questions, actually, so this is good. Cameron Noble has two questions. And Cameron, I'm going to unmute you. I think that might be the easiest way to go about this. So you should be live now, Cameron. Feel free to ask your question.
Hi, yeah, great presentation. My first question is the timeline for analysis. So once the lab receives the sample, how quickly can they turn it around?
It could be a couple of days, I suppose, if you have, you know, the availability, the hands to run it all. We take a sample and extracting DNAs, it's the process. You have kind of an incubation period with the kits that we've been using, so it's kind of an overnight deal. And then, you know, potentially you could do the qPCR analysis that next day, so as little as, you know, 2-3 days for it, you know, assuming you have hands there ready to run that stuff.
Okay, great. And my second question is, how many labs are available to do this analysis, and are there any in Canada that you're aware of?
You know, it seems like I've talked to some folks that are working on this out of Canada, but I'm not sure. I couldn't point you, you know, to anyone specifically. But, you know, I don't know. I haven't really seen a lab that's popped up saying that they're going to kind of be, you know, just a processing house for this where you can send these projects. We do some of this stuff out of Snake River Field Station here in Boise, Idaho. I know we've worked on this stuff through Boise State and through the University of Idaho, and there's a bunch of folks that are doing some of this that have labs. I don't know to what degree their labs are set up and capable of handling a bunch of projects for this stuff. But, you know, if you're trying to find somebody, we can definitely talk after this about getting you connected with somebody.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah.
Great. Thank you, Cameron. Okay, our next, we're going to try unmuting Patrick Dehan. Let's see here. Let me find you in the, where are you? We've got a long-ish question that might be easier to ask.
Can you hear me?
Here we go, Patrick, yeah. You're live.
Hey. I enjoyed that presentation a lot, Matt. My question had to do with sort of how universal the applications are. And so, you know, given what you were saying about variable rates of degradation and production of eDNA in different systems and, you know, variable amounts of contamination and inhibitors and whatever, do you have a sense of whether or not it's possible to develop general protocols that will work everywhere, or do you envision that in each system and species where this is applied, somebody's going to have to go in and do a lot of ground research?
Are you asking, like, as far as density estimates and things based on concentrations or just presence?
Both.
Both. I think presence is a lot easier. I mean, if you're just trying to say, did I collect any, you know, DNA from that target organism, you don't have to be concerned with so many of those, you know, environmental factors. It's just, was there any there or not? But when it comes down to, you know, really trying to apply that, especially if you're trying to use those concentrations as density estimates in, you know, with the goal of like basing management actions on that, I think we got a long ways to go to get there without doing a tremendous amount of that, you know, sort of that groundwork you mentioned, where you have to figure out what's happening to those in the system that you're using, or, you know, where it's being applied. You know, I don't know. I've been kind of a part helping out mostly in the field on some studies where we've got good correlation between eDNA concentrations and, you know, and density of an organism. But that's for one system, you know, one organism. And I don't know how well that would apply. I wouldn't imagine it would apply very well across a bunch of different systems. So that's one of those things. I don't know. I guess there's a lot more we would need to understand about what happens to these molecules in the environment to really be able to make that next jump into, you know, using those quantitative values as any indication of how many the organisms there are. Does that answer your question? Sort of.
It does. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Great. Okay. Next, let's go with Richard McEldowney. I hope I pronounced your name correct. It's all right. You're left, Richard.
Hi. Thanks for a great talk.
Thanks.
I just had a question about the terminology. You said field negative and lab negative controls. Were you referring to things like trip blanks or something else?
Did you catch that, Leslie?
He was wondering about your negatives.
I just didn't catch the last part.
Right, something about trip lines.
Trip blanks.
Oh, trip blanks.
Yeah. I think as far as, you know, at each site, if we were collecting our three water samples, we'd also include one that's just, you know, distilled water, and then just handle it otherwise exactly as we do our actual stream water samples. Handle it with those and then treat it as if it was one, and then we just need to make sure that when that goes through all the analysis that it ends up negative. If we end up with, you know, our target organism's DNA in that trip blank or whatever we were calling it, then, you know we have some sort of contamination at the site. And then as far as on the lab side, you know, there's just using blank wells in your PCR analysis and extraction negatives, so that we'll have something as simple as just a vial that doesn't have one of these filters in it that will process exactly as if it did. They're included at basically every step along the way, just to make sure that we're not, you know, getting DNA from one place to another.
Great. Did that answer your question, Richard?
It sure did. Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you.
Yep.
Okay. Our next question is from Philip Dam. I'm going to go ahead and unmute you. Oh. Are you there, Philip? You there, Philip? All right, I'm going to go ahead and remute him, and then he wrote it in, so I'm going to read it. He would like to know what's the cost of setting up the assay?
Well, you know, I guess it depends on what the target organism is. I mentioned that when it's one that's well studied, there's a lot of sequences available on some of these online databases. So a lot of the work's kind of already done for you when that's the case. When it's a understudied organism, sometimes you don't have a lot of sequences available, so you end up doing a lot more sequencing and things. But a very ballpark figure that we've been using on doing some of this stuff is, you know, $2,000 or $3,000, that obviously depends on what your lab techs and folks are actually charging hourly, but that gets kind of in a ballpark idea for, you know, how much chemicals and time and primers and probes and stuff to actually test that and get a jump on it. But that's, I mean, that can vary widely depending on the organism and how well the design starts out.
Great, I hope that helps. He mentions that he'd have to contract all of this out if it was something he were interested in. So That's probably a good ballpark there.
Yeah, I think it's a starting point. You could go from there, and it's certainly not a figure to run with and say that's what it's going to be, but it's ballpark.
Great. Okay, our next question is from Mary. She would like to know, can this technique be used to detect the presence of aquatic invasive species in a system?
Yeah, definitely. That's one of the primary applications. You know, early on in this field, it's been used a lot of publicity back in the Great Lakes region with invasive carp, and I think there's some other work going on with some invertebrates and things, but yeah, I think it's pretty well suited to that. You know, when you have a species present at low density or determining, a point in time for an invasion, that's such an important part of invasive species work is early detection. So I think it's very well suited for that application.
Great. And our next question comes from Jared Hobbs, and he would like to know, how stable are the samples once they are preserved in ethanol versus just using the water sample method without filtration and ethanol? Oh, I think he said water sample method without filtration and ethanol.
So yeah, I think it's asking about like centrifuging an actual water sample rather than filtering it. I don't know on the comparison. I think that's an area that like needs some attention. Is, I mentioned most of these methods seem to be working. Folks are getting good results using whichever method they're going with. But, which one works best, I don't know. We've been planning to do some comparisons between, filter types and pore size and some of these things, and just see which one gets you the best results. Our samples are stable in ethanol. They should be, rather indefinitely stable in ethanol. I don't know. I think with that water filter method, just the water centrifuging method, which I haven't actually used yet, I think those are also ethanols added to those and then frozen, I think, as well, or just kept at low temp. But either one should be fairly stable. We've got one project where we're starting out and we are trying to use that centrifuging method. And one of the considerations, I guess, for that is when you have to ship those things, it's a little easier to ship small filters rather than the whole water sample. But, I guess I can't answer it directly. I don't know which one's going to be more stable for storage.
Okay, he had a follow-up to that. He said he was curious how the sample, if not stabilized, would be usable for testing. Like, what if it gets hot?
Temperature can definitely have a negative effect on that DNA, on the molecules themselves. So we try to keep things cold as much as we can. You might just have to try some and see if you're getting, if you're able to get usable DNA out of that still. Is it kind of, with the idea, I don't know if it's with the idea of traveling from the field and having to keep these things before you're able to get to a lab or a place where you can actually keep them cold. There might be that period where you're worried about, how stable the DNA is from that point. That might be some of the considerations for which method to actually use. When you can't get the sample back to a freezer or wherever it needs to be, maybe using the ethanol in a filter method is more applicable at that case. I don't know.
Right. That's what he just followed up saying. He is worried about transport from the field and the samples getting cooked.
Yeah. Yeah. We did some work at one point looking at, how temperature affects it, just storing these DNA and seeing if temperatures has a negative effect, and it showed it did. It was definitely, if you can keep them cool, the better.
Great. And Patrick DeHaan wanted to let us all know that C-Star Biotech in Victoria, BC, has been working on eDNA projects. So I know there was a question earlier about some Canadian companies. So C-Star Biotech in Victoria. And then Jared wants you to know that he really, all capital letters, appreciates this talk. Thank you, Jared. Chris Temple wants to know, what about effectiveness in larger water bodies like lakes?
I haven't worked. Everything I've been doing has been in streams and rivers. I'm sure there's some folks that are testing this in larger lakes, but I wouldn't be able to talk directly to it. It'd be, you know, it'd be come down to your actual goals, what you're trying to decide, I'm sure, and what the, you know, some of the life history and things of the organism you're targeting might help you to figure out where to actually sample in that. We've done some little pilot studies that I haven't got around to analyzing yet that try to get an idea, at least in streams, you know, if sampling at the stream surface or on the stream edges or at the bottom of the stream, which one, you know, might be able to actually collect more of the DNA. But I haven't had a chance to look at that stuff yet. So, you know, there's somebody out there, maybe this will help him connect with somebody that's doing some work in larger lakes that can help him out with that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Philip wants to know, do you have any experience with the methodology in wetlands?
No, not necessarily. I don't. There was an early paper that looked at bullfrogs that was, I think, done in small ponds and in wetland environments. That might be a place to start to get an idea of that. But I haven't worked directly. It's all been stream rivers for me.
Mm-hmm. All right. Looks like the questions are slowing down. Give everybody just another minute or so. And in the meantime, again, if you think of a question after we're done here, I'm certainly feel free to call or email Matthew and can follow up with him that way. Okay. Jared says that I think did you finish this, Jared? He's got a master's project in Saskatchewan on tiger salamanders, and they're about to repeat it in Canada. So that sounds like somebody's working on some wetland stuff up there.
Oh, nice.
And then, Kyle Wash is doing that, or Kylie. Boy, I have a hard time with the name, sorry.
Okay.
Kyle Welsh is doing that. Cameron would like to know, can we have your contact info again? Do you mind?
Yeah, I was just trying to get that back up on the screen here.
Cool.
That's a good idea. You see that there?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah, and I'm happy to discuss this stuff. If anybody has some questions or just wants to kind of work out some of this stuff, and if I'm not able to help you with it, there's a chance I can, you know, connect you with somebody else that can.
Great. I think we're coming to the end there.
Okay.
Thanks so much, Matthew. That was really interesting. And thank you all for attending. Again, we have another webinar on February 12th. I hope you join us. You can register by going to greatnorthernlcc.org. It's snowing here in Bozeman, so I hope you all are having really good weather wherever you are.
Great. Thanks, Leslie. Thanks, everybody.
Have a good one.